Hello, welcome to the July 20th, 2015 meeting of the Board of Selectmen. Do I have a motion to accept the minutes from June 22nd, 2015?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Excellent. Seeing that we have no one for public participation, I'm going to take someone before we do license and permits. If Detective Mike O'Connell could come up to the seats, please.
Good evening.
Good evening. Welcome, and I'd like Steve to...
I asked Michael to come. Not everybody knows that Mike O'Connell has retired after a great career as a Wakefield police officer and detective. And I just think it's important that Detective O'Connell comes here, and I wanted to give him my personal thanks for a lot of reasons. Detective O'Connell does have a difficult job. He is often the person that is investigating after crime has been committed. And a lot of times the victims, they feel they did something wrong, and you know, what could they have done differently? And sometimes crime does happen. And I got to say, not only did Detective O'Connell and his partners over there solve the crime, but they made our citizens feel so good about the process and what happened, and that they really shouldn't have any blame on their own. On a personal note, before we had what we call now SROs and what have you, Mike O'Connell was the SRO. And I've got to say that he kept a lot of kids on the straight and narrow, including mine. And we've had discussions about that. But Mike, I just want to tell you, on behalf of myself, as the town administrator, and the police chief is away, so, or he would be here tonight, great you are, how the department is, and how that makes my job very easy. So I want to thank you for your years. Personally, I wanted you here to, for the whole public to hear it. And I will miss you, but as we discussed, you'll be back in to see me, and we'll keep things going. So thank you, Madam Chair. That was what I wanted to say, if anybody else wants to.
I would like to say something.
Certainly, Betsy.
When I got the email from Steve that you were retiring, as you know, I answered it to you personally.
Yes.
I don't think a lot of people know all the time and energy that you put in at the Galvin Junior High School, middle school, I should say. I'm dating myself there. But all the time and energy, not just during the time that you should have been there. I think you made such an impression. I know the teachers were just thrilled with having you there. I know the parents were. And I know you still want to remain involved in the community, and I think that's great. I think you said you just weren't going to pack up and move out or something like that.
No, I'm going to be here.
You're going to be here for a long time. And the lights are in my eyes, and I kept looking over there saying, is that Mike? Is that Mike? I didn't recognize. But I wish you, as I said in the email, the best of everything. You're wonderful, and so much that you've done will never be known by people. I know that.
I really appreciate the showing of support that I received from people in the community over the last month or so. Excuse me. It makes me feel and understand that I came here with a purpose in 1994. I spent 20 years in the private sector before I became a cop, and I really wanted to be able to make a difference. And with the support of the town, particularly in the last 10 years, Mr. Mayo, the chief of police here, Chief Smith, the people I work with, have been very supportive of the efforts that we put forth, both in the schools and in the community. And through a great team effort, we've had tremendous results. It's really just been very, very rewarding. And just being here tonight and hearing what you guys have to say reaffirms that. I really support, and as I've said to folks, a number of folks here, I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to be around. If I can help out, please let me know.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I just want to chime in. I just want to say thanks for your service, and I hope you have a nice, long, healthy retirement, and we hope to see your face around Wakefield.
Very good, Mr. Cohen. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Absolutely. That was an easy one. Item number three. We have a motion. We need a motion and a second to approve the entertainment license for Portobello.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. I'd like to ask Dave Hatfield to come up right to the mic. Dave, as chairman of the Board of Appeals, has written a letter that we allowed to be read a couple of, I believe the last meeting or the meeting prior to that. So if you could simply read your letter, Dave, that would be great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good evening, Board. Mr. Mayo. So again, I received a letter from Steve on June 23rd regarding the letter that was read into the record on the June 10th, or the June meeting of the Board of Selectmen. I'd like to begin by offering some perspective. As you know, the ZBA handles dozens of applications a year, 84 as in 2014. And we easily spend over 100 hours in public hearings, plus occasional site visits to review site conditions and completion of orders of condition that accompany many of our decisions. The vast majority of the applications that come before us involve little or no content. I believe this matter has escalated to you and the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Mayo, primarily due to a few isolated incidents that have occurred during one particularly highly publicized application, the Shelter Development LLC, or Brightview Project. I can assure you and the Board of Selectmen that the ZBA strives to always act in a professional, respectful, and courteous manner with all applicants and members of the public who come before the Board. The ZBA opened hearings with Shelter Development on October 8, 2014. So we've been at this for 9 months, and we have a little ways to go, we believe. I feel the vast majority of our hearings have gone well. We've made a lot of progress with input from all parties involved. Admittedly, there have been some strong opinions about this project, and on a few occasions, some heated discussions have occurred between the applicant, the board, and the public, which I've tried to control as chair. I don't think any party can claim they haven't had an opportunity to participate in this hearing process. Public testimony has been heard at every hearing on this application, from people in support of the project as well as from people who are opposed to certain aspects of the project. Our board has also taken extra steps to accommodate the public by the following: asking the applicant to have two easels presenting evidence, site plans, and so forth, one facing the audience and one facing the board, and asking them to present to the audience. We've allowed up to two court stenographers at our meetings and allowed them to place themselves in positions of their choice to help facilitate recordings of our hearings. And most recently, we've also allowed representatives of opponents of the project to make a summary presentation of their arguments against certain aspects of the project, which to this board's collective memory was the first such time an event has been allowed. This request was allowed not because it was required, but as a courtesy following lengthy discussion and testimony over the past 9 months. With respect to the specific point, the Civic League letter to the Board of Selectmen, I'd like to offer a few comments. The use of electronic devices. Yes, it is true. Board members sometimes use laptops, tablets, or phones to look up copies of documents that are or other material that are in the public record when they may not have hard copies in front of them. In addition, members' phones are set to vibrate so as not to interfere with our meetings, though the same cannot always be said true for members of the public. With respect to reading during testimony, a recent letter to the editor complained in part that a member, quote, who was reading while a member of the public was reading her letter into the record. Former Chairman Michael Pierce has noted that the letter writer never identified the member who was reading. But in his opinion, such a vague allegation could act to make all members look disrespectful of proffered testimony when in fact the exact opposite was the case.
I'll point out that everybody here is reading right now while you're speaking.
Right. Mr. Pierce informed me that he knows this to be true since he was reading that letter during the time the letter was being read verbally. He further states that he was reading and rereading it as it was being read into the record to ensure he fully understood the presenter's position, that he has done this on numerous occasions during his tenure on the board, and he fully intends to continue to do so when appropriate. With respect to, and I quote, gestures made in response to public testimony, as chair, I've tried to stay focused on all speakers, so I can't speak specifically to how often this may have happened by individual board members. I do acknowledge that gestures have occurred on a few occasions when board members have become frustrated with comments or questions made by the public. And I offer a few examples. One stipulation we've made throughout our hearings is that testimony be directed at the topics being discussed at that evening's hearings. We've covered a lot of topics over the course of several months. And this is done mainly to help us stay on point through the many aspects of this complex project which the board has had to consider. Some people have strayed from this request on multiple occasions. Some questions have been asked that were already answered during discussion between the applicant and the board, which preceded our taking public testimony. The board naturally wondered if the person asking the question, who supposedly has a great interest in this project, if they were actually paying attention during the earlier discussion. Or perhaps we're raising the issue again in an attempt to make an argumentative point, or perhaps to, quote, raise the hackles of the board for a potential later argument on appeal alleging that one or more members were acting arbitrarily or capriciously. Most recently at our June 10th hearing, Ms. Ann Fendel made a statement that she felt the project had been kept secret, which led to some strong reactions by the board members, naturally. And those reactions were noted in the Daily Item and the Civic League's letter. I can assure you that the entire project has met open meeting laws, which include notifying abutters, advertising the Daily Item, and posting agendas in Town Hall. There are backroom deals with anyone in Town Hall to push this project through. There have been countless Daily Item articles written by Mr. Mark Sardella, letters written to the Daily Item forum, and various discussions taken to social media. So for anyone to allege that anything is being done secretively around this proposed project is completely baseless and without merit. I would further note that Ms. Fendel stated in her June 10th hearing that it was the first one she attended on this application. Yet she is a direct abutter who was notified prior to the first meeting and is a party in a suit filed in land court early this year pertaining to certain aspects of this project. With respect to eating food, admittedly, there have been some late nights at our meetings, some lasting past midnight, to hear the shelter case as well as many other applications that require our attention. Board members are busy with work, school, family obligations, sometimes drinks or snacks. Without further explanation by the writer of the letter to the Board of Selectmen, one might assume that ZBA members are consuming sandwiches or slices of pizza in a party atmosphere, when in fact members can be seen drinking water, coffee, or similar beverage, an occasional piece of hard candy, or something like a bag of peanuts. And most of the time this can be observed several minutes between the end of one case and the beginning of the next. And lastly, derogatory remarks and personal attacks. The Civics League letter to the Board of Selectmen doesn't include specific examples, nor can I recall any such attacks. Please let me know if you or the Board of Selectmen have any additional questions or feedback for the ZBA on this matter. Very truly yours, David W. Hatfield, Chairman, Wakefield Zoning Board of Appeals.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hatfield, for answering thoughtfully and thoroughly.
Thank you. Any questions or comments?
I'll go ahead. Thanks, Dave, for coming in and doing that. I think we owed you the same forum here that was afforded to folks who came in and tried to disparage your board and the work that you're doing. I've done a little bit of research myself, and just for the record, you know, I was a member of the Board of Appeals for, I think, almost 10 years myself, so I know what it's like to be on that board. I know what it's like to be in the middle of a heated case, a long case. I know what it's like to have snacks late at night. Sometimes people come right from work directly to Town Hall to just make the meeting that starts at 7 o'clock and don't have dinner. I mean, it happens. It's a commitment that you guys have made. That's why people need to eat or have a drink while they're sitting there for hours on end. Which brings me to kind of overarching point is to remind everybody dealing with this board is that this is a board made up of volunteers. They are appointed by this board, but they are just that. They're volunteers. They're people who said, I care about the town. There's something good I'd like to do. How can I get involved? How can I help? How can I make a difference? And it's a very small group that do volunteer. I realize people have commitments and things and families to raise, but there are people that step up, and this is how they give back to society in general. And that's what you guys are doing. So for anybody to vilify people for how they might dress, how they might, whether they have a sip of water or a snack while they're sitting there for 5 hours doing their duty that they've taken an oath to perform, I don't have any patience for that. So I think you guys do a great job managing the meetings and running through them. And again, it's a volunteer activity that you're doing for the town, and you guys do it well. I think with respect to people speaking in the meetings, I know that one of the hardest part, especially in these larger emotional hearings, the hardest part is keeping order, which is a job that falls on you. And we're trying to structure 9 months of hearings into some logical fashion. It's almost like writing a paper in college. Okay, paragraph one, we're going to cover this. And you try to take it off and take it into bite size, which are dictated typically by the bylaws. They kind of indicate, here's the chunks you need to consider. And I know you guys do a great job of working through that. And so if there's something that's discussed in month two and somebody shows up anew in month six and that has been put to bed, they don't have a right to reopen it. In fact, I think one of the greatest misconceptions, and it's a credit to how our board operates in this town, one of the greatest misconceptions is that the public has the right to speak at all. They don't. It's not our laws, it's a state law. There's no right to public participation at a zoning board meeting. The public participates at the whim and invitation of the chairman of the Board of Appeals. And so for somebody to say they have some right to open up something that has been settled months ago, in the interest of efficiency and so forth, you don't need to hear from them. But you do. You still do, and you let people go. And I know that there's a great deference given to allowing people to speak, because that's the process within our society in general, and certainly here in Wakefield. To let people be heard, especially the people who are opposed to a position you might be taking, letting them be heard is vitally important to the whole process. That's why the hearing takes 9 months. It would take a lot shorter if we didn't hear from anybody else other than the person proposing the project. So I think that the process that you've run has been a transparent one, a fair one, an open one. People have had the opportunity to be heard, albeit not their right, and you've done a great job with that. So. And I know it's hard. And so with that, I just want to address kind of the idea that somebody might be, I think the core of what ended up in the newspaper was this idea that somebody may have laughed or snickered or something while somebody else was speaking. For me, I think, and having been on the board, you're almost like a court, right? You're conducting a hearing. They give sworn testimony before they speak. And so one of your jobs as a member of the board is to assess the credibility, just like a judge or jury would, of any witness or anybody proposing or offering any evidence in front of any tribunal. And so I think that when, and getting back to the fact that you're remembering your volunteers, your humans, your fellow citizens of this town, for somebody to come in and claim that the project has been conducted under, and let me get my quotes right, right, here's what it said in the paper, claiming that that the entire project has been kept rather secretive and that she just found out about the project. And the date of that was June 11th, so about a month ago, just found out about the project. I have the abutters list here that says she got written notice on September 9th, 2014, that this project was being filed and the relief was being sought with the zoning board. So she had written notice, which is what the law requires, nothing more, nothing less, not to mention the extensive coverage of her on television, mentioned at this meeting, people protesting downtown. You can't miss this thing. And then the final straw for me is for somebody to say, I just learned about this project in June of 2015, and I'm holding in my hand a complaint filed in the Land Court March 20th, 2015, in her name, Ann Fandel, versus the inhabitants of the town of Wakefield. Signed, Ann Fandel. Here's a signature, zoom in. 7th day of March, to actually participate as a plaintiff in a very, very active way in a lawsuit against the town over this project, and to walk into the zoning board meeting and try to cast some dispersions or aspersions on the process by saying, I just learned about this, I think is at best disingenuous. And I think that a lot of us, you know, we try to say, does something pass the straight face test? It wouldn't for me. I couldn't go in and say that. And I would suggest that for people who have been worn down, for instance, listening to the public regurgitate information, for somebody to come in who has played that active of a role in opposing the project and try to claim, I just learned about it, and this has been very secretive, that is laughable. So God bless you all for being human and laughing at the laughable. Should you do it? You shouldn't. Did it happen? Yes. Is it reasonable? I think it's quite reasonable. I think that's laughable. And I think it's symbolic of the entire opposition to this project. The folks who have come in and just keep trying to dredge up dirt, cast aspersions against the board when their actual substantive arguments fail, it's really been a sad process to watch for years now. The levels and the depths to which people will go
to propagate things that aren't true for their benefit and to play white knight in this town, you know, when it benefits them. I just think it's a shame that that's where it is, and I commend you guys for tolerating it, giving deference to those who want to speak, even when what they say is laughable. So I commend you for a tremendous job well done. I haven't seen a more difficult hearing, except maybe Shaw's years ago. Pat was on the board then. I have never seen a more difficult one, and you are to be commended, and I think the people of the town of Wakefield, as Ms. Fandel calls them, the inhabitants of the town of Wakefield, should know the job you're doing and the credibility or lack thereof of the people who are opposing what you're doing. So kudos to you. You have my full support always. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Feldman.
Mr. Glenn.
Yeah, as Brian mentioned, I'm a former member of the Zoning Board of Appeals, 4 years. And Dave, thank you for the thoughtful response. I think it was incumbent upon you to respond to the letter. And I agree with most of the things you said. I applaud your standing up for the board. I too support the board members. I sat through the Shaws 11 months. It took long nights, sometimes till 1 a.m. I will, having the benefit of 10 plus years on public boards in town, I will say I agree a tremendous amount of patience is in order. And I would say patience in respect to the people in front of you, regardless of what they put in front of you, is decorum, and avoid any kind of disrespectful or facial. I'm not saying accusing you folks of anything. I wasn't there, but by partaking in that kind of behavior, you're giving people a vehicle to criticize. I didn't see it, but if people are rolling their eyes or laughing or whatever, I pull and I would avoid it. That's my only advice. Every other point that you pointed out, I stand behind you, and I agree, and I think I commend the Zoning Board for their patience and their hard work and volunteer, because that's what it is. It's a volunteer position. It's thankless, and if you look around the town and see the good work that this board has done, it's everywhere. The evidence is everywhere. It is numerous projects around town, so that's my two cents.
Thank you, Mr. Glenn. I appreciate your feedback.
Yes, I would just like to say, I think as chair of the Board of Appeals, it was incumbent upon you to respond, and I understand that. Perception is reality to a lot of people, and it's very difficult to deal when something is a very emotional issue. I would hope that we could move forward. We, as a town, as a community, forward. You've responded. The complaint was made. You've responded. And I would like to think it doesn't become a he said, she said, a back and forth again, because I think that's a waste of everyone's time and energy, and it should continue in a very positive manner. You're holding your hearings, people going on, whatever side they're on. Everyone's entitled to his or her opinion, and I understand that. But you are the board that will adjudicate this, more or less. I might be overemphasizing the word. But I would hope that this will kind of settle things down and take the emotions out of it and move on. As I said, every citizen in this town is allowed to make a comment, whether you agree or disagree, okay? And you have to take I don't mean you personally, but a step has to be taken back. We find it here all the time. A step has to be taken back, and our own personal issues can't enter into it. So I'm happy that you responded. I think it had to be done. I think it had to be done in public, and that's fine, and I hope everyone forward now. You know, I think everyone involved on both sides has the intelligence to do that. I believe that. I truly do. Thank you.
I would agree. Thank you, Michelle.
Thank you. Mr. Hatfield, thank you very much for coming in and responding to our request. It's not an easy job that you do. I've had my share when I was on the planning board for 9 years, dealing with the public, and sometimes be very arduous. But you're handling yourself well, and so is your board. So I commend the entire ZBA for the long process that they're trying to perform here with the handling of such a matter. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Tanaka.
Thanks so much, Dave, for coming in.
Okay, thank you for having me.
Good luck. I'd like to now call Patrick Sullivan and to the microphone. We called you both in independently and collectively to thank you for putting on unbelievable parade and 4th of July celebration before and after. It was, I have heard nothing but great comments from folks that didn't know what to expect because it was something new, and to still have the familiar traditions was phenomenal. So that's why we came in, so folks could just say thank you so much, and we appreciate, can't imagine the hard work it took.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to? So yes, Pat.
Sure. yeah, I would say that I'm overwhelmed. You didn't miss a beat. Many of us here participated in this for years, and it was very efficiently run. I saw Patrick driving around in his golf cart, almost ran me over a couple of times, but you had your headset on and you were in charge, and fantastic job by you guys and the whole group. Very efficient operation, and congratulations. Thank you for doing it.
Thank you.
Phyllis, and then Paul.
Well, I think everybody in town knows how much I wanted that 4th of July parade to come back. I mean, I talked about it, said we should do away with other things, but bring back that parade. And certainly everybody knows how patriotic I am. It's what I'm like. And I have to tell you, I was so proud to walk those 2 miles in the rain in that parade. It just was. There isn't anyone I talk to, there isn't anyone I see that doesn't think that was the best thing that's happened to this town in years. You know, for someone that was just given that job, you are to be commended. You and that, your group, your committee, I know you had lots of help, but you are to be commend job that you did. I just love you for doing that.
Thank you, Phyllis.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to thank both the Independence Day Committee and the West Side Social Club for a job well done this year. Patrick, you brought back the parade, something that we've missed for a few years now. You did a great job of doing so. And once again, the West Side Social Club put on a heck of a display with the fireworks at the end of the evening. I commend both of you. It's a lot of work, knowing firsthand how much it takes to do something like this. And you pulled it off with a lot of great support. And good luck in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I won't reiterate everything, but just for me, I found the parade to be a point of civic pride in the town of Wakefield. It's, you know, it's like our lake. It's one of the best parades around. It's something that we can be proud of. It's something that differentiates us from other communities. And to kind of just disappear overnight was a real shame. And I had I didn't have the highest of hopes that it would be resurrected, and certainly that it would be resurrected so well, so quickly. So really congratulations to you, and thank you on behalf of, you know, the town, but, you know, my kids, my family, they had a great time there. They're prouder about living in Wakefield because of the parade. Whether you know it or not, it's a big deal in the town. So really congratulations on making a real difference and stepping up when seeing something that needed to be fixed and stepping up and just taking it by the horns and doing it. Wonderful, wonderful example for everybody and everything, and tremendous for this town. So, great job.
Thank you.
Beth. Yes, congratulations. As someone who announces from the in front of the reviewing stand for the past 7 years, it went like clockwork. And that's music to my ears. And I use the term, it's a double entendre, because you had some fantastic drum and bugle corps and music groups there. It was wonderful, and it came along just like clockwork, according to schedule and everything. But I would like to also compliment the group that used to put on the parade, Tommy Doran, Steve Daly, and all of their volunteers who came back this year, Jake McKay, who came back this year, and, you know, just to help with the logistics, because it happens all of a sudden.
Couldn't have done it without them.
Go, and then, you know, it's game on. And it was nice to see them there in your new T-shirts, as opposed to their other ones. And I haven't named everyone that came back, but you know the group that came back. And I think it was very nice of them to do that. And I'm very happy that it's back. But congratulations, because it went like clockwork. It was excellent.
Thank you very much.
Right.
if we're almost done here, you know, I want to know what do you need from us? Do you need anything going forward? And what can we do to help you? Well, obviously, we support you, so if you don't have anything now, let us know.
I can't speak for the West Side Social Club.
Speak right now. Our committee of volunteers is meeting and discussing ways that we can make the parade better for next year. Meeting over at the public safety building right now, actually. Throughout the past year, me and Steve communicated throughout the year. And so if anything does arise that we do need the help of the Board of Selectmen for, then I'll definitely be in touch through Steve and through all of you. And I thank all of you for your help the past year. And we've met all of our goals, and we had a fantastic parade back this year. And the West Side Social Club did a fantastic job, starting at 7:30 in the morning all the way through until 10 o'clock at night, keeping everybody entertained outside of the few hours that the parade was going on. So it was a great day, all in all. Thank you.
Steve.
I just wanted to thank both of you as well, and I know that I got you guys to come in here after the chairman wanted you in here, and rightly so. Selectman Falvey, we have an after-event meeting scheduled for next
Tuesday.
Next Tuesday. Yeah, those are some confusion of the date on my part. But next Tuesday, where we talk about, what went right, what we could have done better, what we need to do together next year, and it'll be attended by police, fire, public works, health, MLD, to talk about all of these things that we need to do better next year, and we have some ideas, and I'm glad that you guys are meeting to see what we can all do better next year. What's really gratifying to me, and I think the whole board said how great it is to have the event weekend back, is that from 7 o'clock that morning, really starting a few days before, we had the movie on the Common. Then we had the events, the children's events in the Common. We then had the parade. We then have the fireworks and what have you at night. What a great time to be in Wakefield. And while other communities, the board needs to know, they're abandoning this. They're not doing the parade. They're not doing the celebrations. We are. And kind of gives me, I meet with the fellow managers around here. But I think it says a lot about particularly your two groups, but about the community that they supported. So I think what we can do is we can promote it more. We can get more people to donate earlier. So we're not scrambling at the last minute, as both of you guys know.
Oh, yeah.
But we'll work together on that, too. But I do thank you for really stepping up and making Wakefield a great place to live.
Steve, how many people did we estimate?
We estimated at the evening close to 70,000 people. Between, the Vets Field, the Common, the head of the lake.
That's great. It's a lot of people.
Yeah. It is a lot of people.
So if we could hit each one of them up for $5, we'd pay right? So we're going to do this next year. We're going to figure something out, right?
Steve, I think you have to thank the DPW, because I walked to the lake the next morning. And you would have never known.
Yeah.
There were 70,000 people traveling through. Yeah. So whoever was involved in that cleanup, your crew and the DPW, police, everybody.
They really did a great job. And I do want to thank you guys again.
Thank you. We had a high school band. Some people might have seen this on Facebook. We had a high school band out from Minnesota.
Right.
Brothers had donated a breakfast for them on the Monday morning they were going to leave. They stayed over in the high school for that weekend. Yeah. And the band directors from that Minnesota band had come up to me, and they said that after they had finished the parade, they had gone down to the Common for the concert and for the fireworks. And
nice.
They're like, I don't even think any of the students in our band know who Rod Stewart was. Every single one of them was out and dancing and having a great time to Rod Stewart and the fireworks. And
that really kind of bothers me.
It just bothered me, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, sorry, next year. Okay.
But they had a great time that day, that weekend. They went into Boston, they did the Freedom Trail. Then they had that breakfast at Brothers and then at the end of their breakfast they had sung for the owners there. Their chorus sung as a thank you.
Nice.
And they had such a great time. They said they go on this trip out east every 4 years. They said they'd be back in 4 years, and they said that they would be. All the band directors from the Midwest, they talk together and figure out where they're going, and they're gonna try to get some more groups out here for years to come as well.
Great.
And so it was a great reflection on Wakefield to way out in Minnesota for all the groups that were involved on the 4th of July.
Yeah. Thank you. Well done.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
I'd next like to call Joseph Bertrand up to the microphone from the Permanent Building Committee, who has some great updates. Anyone with two eyes can see that that building is on task, on time. The budget has been meticulously followed, so the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to report that substantial completion of the contract occurred Thursday, July 16th, 2015, and that the building inspector, Jack Roberto, granted the certificate of occupancy on Thursday as well, on July 16th. The remaining issues left are the punch list items in the, and as well as exterior work, and the committee expects that those will be completed by August 1st. The additional skate park that was an add-on to the project, the concrete has been laid, and that is expected to be concluded maybe not by August 1st, but shortly thereafter at the worst. At the present time, there were three different contingencies that were built into this. The contingencies for bond and other contingencies have been used up. However, the owner's contingency, which is our contingency, we have substantial monies left. We are under budget. However, there are three different groups looking for some more dollars, including someone sitting here at the table, Mr. Mayo. The school, there are certain other items that have been requested for approximately the last 3 to 4 months. The committee, for any additional requests that were made that were not absolutely 100% necessary for safety and health issues, were held in abeyance. We did not grant any of them until the end of the project to see what monies are left. Then at that time, the committee will make a decision as to how to use the remaining owner's contingency. So there are some issues with the school. There are some, not only some issues from IT overtime, but also the police department has requested for additional security cameras, and the police came in and talked to us last month. We put that in abeyance also until the end. And so we should be, and there's also a request from bond for what's known as winter conditions due to the lovely winter that we've had, and cost extra dollars. And we are very confident, without any doubt, that we will be able to meet some, if not all, of those remaining issues within the budget. We will not exceed it. The contingency used so far has been used for unforeseen costs, and those included over $1 million for soil and asbestos. Unfortunately, the soil there was not great, and unfortunately, there was a lot less than originally thought. The other contingency used was used for an extra science lab that was not in the original design that was requested by Superintendent Reich, and some other issues that have been done, and the committee has had to deal with not one superintendent, but three. And they all had their own views, and they all have asked you what was to be done. But beyond that, I am just a spokesman for this committee, and I think that those individuals have worked long and hard on this project and deserve to be named: Chris Callanan, Mike Gentassi, Lisa Butler, Phil Crosscup, Jim Lappery, and our secretary, Chip Darbell, who wouldn't come up here with me. They are to be commended for the hard work that all of those individuals did, some of them meeting every 2 weeks going over this project. There's the high school. I know there was a request as to the evaluation study that's being done at the high school. In June, the Permanent Building Committee picked Doran Whittier out of Newburyport to perform the evaluation study. They have previously done many studies at different schools, including one at the Volk presently. They have their bid for the study. The town meeting granted $150,000. In an article, the cost of the study is $109,000. And that includes the educational visionary aspect of it, not just the building. And that was one of the things that we, one of the reasons why Doran Whittier were picked as well, because they were, they included the educational part of the study well within the budget. There will be some other additional expenditures, for example, in looking at potential enrollment issues, something that the MSBA likes to have it done by a third party as to how many people are going to be there, how many kids, how many students, rather than having them do it or we do it, you hire someone else to do it. And we learned that from our first meeting with Doran Whittier that occurred on July 8th. At that time, we set up a schedule. Beginning this week, there will be an informal walk through the high school on the 22nd. On the 29th, there will be a formal walkthrough with Doran Whittier and all of their consultants, and a complete evaluation of the physical aspect of the building will occur in July and August. As for the educational visionary aspect of the study, that will begin in September when the teachers are back and the administration is back as well. There will be September and October for that aspect. We will also hold a public meeting in September regarding the educational aspect, and it is expected that the report by Doran Whittier will be done by December or January in time for putting together a statement of interest to the MSBA, which is due between the January, February, March time period, somewhere in there, so that that study will be completed in time for the next round of the MSBA. So if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Yes.
Yeah, I just want to commend Joe on picking up the reins on this project, becoming chairman. And
it wasn't that hard after John.
It's true. It's true. You're falling in some, you get some big shoes to fill. So great job, though. I sat through several meetings with the advisory committee along with the PBC, and Joe and the whole team is to be commended on a project that start to finish, not an easy one, and there were some challenges with soil and hazmat and things like that, but you know, every meeting I can tell you that this committee took it seriously. They spent this money like it was their own savings, and I can point out Chip Tarbell spent God knows how many hours in construction meetings on his own time, meeting with contractors, making sure, you know, talking through problems and issues, and the whole committee did a great job. It was a great experience and an example for other communities, so.
Thank you, Ben. By the way, I forgot to mention, I hope everybody will be able to see the new gym and the music rooms, which are, and that were performed in the lockers, that are just outstanding. It really looked great.
Yes, Phyllis.
Mr. Bertrand, I'd like to ask you a question, something that has come up. Maybe you could answer this for me. The question about the air conditioning unit in the new Galvin, about a ramp so that people could get in to repair that if there's a problem with the air conditioning. I think you know what I'm talking about, right?
The doors?
Yeah.
No, no.
And
you want me to respond?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm a lawyer. He's the equipment guy.
Okay. The reason I'm asking this is, from what I understand, I'm not an architect, I'm not a builder, but I do have some common sense about this kind of thing. If something goes wrong with that and there's not a ramp to get in there, and it's, I know once that unit gets in there that it will be very difficult to get it out of there, does that mean that we have to hire someone to go in and get that unit out, you know, at another cost to the town every time?
No, you know? not. I don't know, Phyllis, and I, with all due respect, want to react too strongly, but I don't know where you get your information, but all the information you just stated is absolutely 100% wrong.
So there would be no
problem. Let me tell you about the problem that was either discussed or
well,
whatever you heard
problem.
About. There was an air conditioning unit up in the ceiling.
Right.
When it was first designed, it did not have appropriate access.
Right.
Once we found out about that, as there are many times, and that's why you have a contingency, we created appropriate access. There now was fully, this came up in the music center, which is the last phase of the project, actually building D out of A, B, C, and D. It was one of the last air conditioning units installed. And all that had to happen was a small platform that hadn't been designed, built right outside where the air conditioning unit is, so a ladder can go up to that platform, can stand on that platform, access, fix, and repair the air conditioning unit.
Was the platform designed to go there?
There was no platform designed to go there.
Right, but we put one in.
There was no platform. There's a lot of things that aren't in the design that you use the contingency to fix.
Right.
That was one of those items.
Okay.
Phyllis, and I'll chime in on this. I looked at the HVAC, and I was 14 years a professional in the industry, and I missed it. You can't fix a unit without access. And one thing that I've also spent my career working on construction projects in and around them, things, you can't think of everything. You do your best. You put as many eyes upon it as you can. And we did in this project. This was an oversight.
But when something comes up,
this was
you have engineers look at it and
that's
you fix
why you
it.
Have contingency.
And that's what we did.
Okay. All right. Don't all jump at me at once. In the beginning,
No,
there was a problem. I know there was. I don't know that there was a problem.
2 weeks.
But there was a
problem. Yeah, in the past 2 weeks.
And my question is, has it been taken care of?
Yes.
The answer to that is yes.
So.
And it actually got printed in the paper that Mr. Roberto was holding back the occupancy
right.
permit.
He was,
this
and
was
that
fixed.
Was in the paper that he was holding
it
back.
Was.
And, I think
he actually didn't hold back.
Yeah.
That was actually a misquote in the paper. Mr. Roberto was upset it got quoted that way.
I read.
Well, I know, but guess what? We should all know we can't believe everything you read.
I understand that, but
okay.
I still think.
Well, I learn that every day, Phyllis, as I'm sure you
believe
do too.
Me, nobody
you
learns
got more
it,
days than I do.
Nobody learns it more than I do.
So I appreciate that you watch it and are care about the project, but
right.
these things do happen, and it was a very minor fix, and as Joe reported, we got our occupancy permit that Mr. Roberto signed off on July 16th, which was an in date and in time. So, and we moved on.
Fine.
And it is fine now.
Madam Chairman, I would just like to say, you've gone through three superintendents over X number of years. I can't imagine the man hours.
Four, if you count that there was two.
Yeah.
That's right. Sorry.
We actually never saw the other one.
I understand.
That's true. I never did.
Yeah. All right. Now, gentlemen.
Sorry.
You were luckier than I was.
All of, you know, really.
The quorum.
It's just falling apart right
didn't
now.
Didn't we just have a...
Take all to yourselves.
He'll drop the loudie.
I can't imagine the man hours, women hours.
Complain.
I'm not trying to be sexist when I say man hours that have gone into this project. I know you meet constantly, and I'm very pleased that there's been continuity within the group. You know, people that are following the project, and it's not your first rodeo. I understand that. Joe, you and I were on the
yes,
police
we
and
were.
Fire. How long ago was that?
Uh-huh.
I don't even, never mind. But I'm just saying it was
no
a while
comment.
Back, you know? And it has come along so well and to be within budget because things happen. And you have to fix them, obviously, but to still come in under budget, I think it's great. I think you people have kept your thumb on the pulse of it, working with, you know, other people within the community. But the whole oversight has really been with you people, and I commend you on that. I just think it looks beautiful. It's not an eyesore anymore. It's a nice... almost a gateway into the, you know, the downtown. I think it's very nice. Congratulations.
Well, the thing that you'll thank you first, and the thing that you'll see, which is the last thing being completed, is the decorative fence along Main Street, which will really clean up. Some of the granite poles are in now.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be a metal, nice fencing in there, and I think as you come from Melrose, that's really going to start off the downtown. I hope that the other side of the street can now start
mm-hmm.
picking
right.
up a
yep.
little bit.
Right.
The decorative fence actually was one of the very first thing that we complained about that we wanted. And that was 2.5 years ago.
A long time ago.
So we're going to be happy to finally see it.
Yeah. Awesome. All right.
Anything else? Job well done.
Thank you so much for coming in
Thank
and
you.
Reporting.
No problem.
Great job. Thank you, Chip. All right. I'd like to call Alicia Redden up to speak about the Civil War Memorial. Thank you, Alicia.
Hi.
Okay.
lots of seats to choose from. Wasn't sure where to go there. So. Land right in the middle. Good evening. Thank you so much for having me in to talk tonight. So I'm here representing the Wakefield Veteran Advisory Board, as well as my own office, the Veteran Services Office. As mentioned back in February, we did commission an estimate be put together on restoring the Sailors and Soldiers Monument on the Common. The number on that came to be $556,000, and that quote will be shared via email at the conclusion of this evening's meeting once I get back into my office. We have also been working on a tree dedication in honor of military service of women from the Revolutionary War forward. And the cost of that monument came in just under $1,000 and was 100% donated from Woodlawn Memorial. So that will cost us nothing at all to put in. And the DPW has been kind enough to put it in for us. And we're aiming for November for that to do a full ceremony.
Where is that going, Alicia?
On the Common. We're still working out the logistics mm-hmm. with which tree we're going to dedicate. Ideally, it's going to be that magnolia that's kind of right outside Town Hall across the way.
Sure.
Yeah, it's a very, it's a beautiful flowering tree.
And awesome.
So we're hoping to dedicate that come November. Upon beginning this entire project, having the memorial looked at, and we've received quite a bit of feedback on the Korean War Memorial, the Vietnam War Memorial, and potential improvements mm-hmm. to the Common, which I have to say, I agree, really does need to be addressed. The memorials have really fallen into disrepair. Of course, when we initially put these up, we don't always think about the longevity and the long-term cost of upkeep, but I think that's something that is really important to address now. So I'm here to request that a committee be commissioned to investigate the viability of the monument project, and to also hear and collect requests for future memorials and potential improvements to the Veteran Common. And I request that the committee be staffed with interested parties that have knowledge, skills, and experience in this area, if possible. And so that's why I came out tonight. And hopefully you guys agree that there's some work that needs to be done there, especially since we have that beautiful World War II monument. And so right. to have other ones falling apart around it just doesn't seem right.
I'm 100% behind it, and be happy to partake in any kind of a committee. The Soldiers and Sailors Monument, I've mentioned it a number of times. It's a one of a kind. It's hand carved, and they just don't make them like that anymore. They're all bronze today, which is fine, but a hand carved granite statue like that, is a monument like that, is one of a kind. In the Civil War, I mean, 500,000 people died. You know, it should be something that we maintain. So we should figure out a way to make that happen. So thank you for doing it. And I know we had walked through and looked at some of the other, and they do need upkeep. And so.
Yeah.
Oh, Betsy.
I was just going to ask, but I don't want to cut Brian off. If we should have a motion to have the interested parties submit resumes to the town
yes.
administrator and Alicia
yes.
and have you be the other pro, you know truthfully, you know, looking at the group.
I think Phyllis is the pro.
I'm yes. sorry.
Absolutely.
I cannot compare. I'm not going to fight that fight. It's too hot, and I'm not going to do it.
I think it's only 98 right now.
Oh,
outside.
Fine. It's cooled off then. But I think that's the way that
absolutely.
I would prefer to see it go, and it makes it a lot easier for you, I think.
Absolutely. I would love to have a hand in putting together the committee if that would be acceptable to all involved.
I concur.
So I'd like to make that motion.
Second.
There you go.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I would be happy
can
to
we
be
still speak
on that
about
and to
Brian
help to raise money to see whatever we can do. And I know there are other people in town that would be happy to do that because it's got to be fixed.
It does.
It does.
It does. There's no imminent danger at this point, but it only takes a few major storms, which we've been having in increasing numbers lately. So I want to make sure that we catch it before it's a $2 million repair.
Yeah. At least we have an eye on and what we have to do and how and we have to raise some money. Is there any way of getting some grants?
So I've reached out to Daniel Benjamin, who sits on my Veteran Advisory Board, also sits with the Historical Commission. Sorry, I always confuse the two, so I apologize if that's not the correct term. And he is doing some research as well. We have numerous members of the advisory board that have started to do kind of on-the-ground grant research to see what's out there. And we're also searching for grants for other monuments. If we can't find one for Civil War, we're still looking for Korea. We're still looking for Vietnam. There are monies out there. It's just a matter of kind of pulling together our resources.
Have you reached out to the GAR associations? The Grand Army of the Republic associations there's sometimes interest from those groups, in especially in a monument like this.
That is very helpful. It costs approximately $2,000 to have that initially done, and I asked the granite company to price match, and they were not interested in repairing it for $2,000. Right, yeah. That's
Brian.
Just a couple of things. What does the repair entail? Do they take the monument out or something? Is that what they do? And
so there were two different ways to approach this. The one that we elected to lean towards was the one where they actually remove the monument, because to fix it on site would completely destroy the landscape. We would have to remove the trees to have cranes come in. It's beautiful, so that didn't seem like a real option. So what they would do is they would bring in a crane from the sidewalk, one of those long-reaching cranes, and they would disassemble it. It's actually only a few parts. 90% of that is one huge column. So they would take that apart, truck it back to Vermont, where they would clean the joints, redo the corners and the edges, bring it back, set it all back up, and then correctly put it back together. It had looked like some repairs had maybe attempted to be made a couple decades ago with some what looked like grout.
It's epoxy, yeah.
Epoxy, okay. And it had actually...
Pat did.
I bet.
That's why one of the guy's arms is missing.
So that had actually caused a little bit of additional damage because it had sealed in some moisture, which caused some plant growth in between the joints and is now pushing it apart, which is why we needed to completely disassemble that base, that hexagon, that's one piece.
Awesome.
And so then there's an outside piece, which is where you see the... So it's a complex job, but they've laid out a very comprehensive plan that I'll make
How many bids did you get? I'm just curious.
We were only able to get one bid. There's only two companies nationally that can even deal with this monument due to its size and the location of the of the companies. Vermont Granite Works was actually, it's now a different name, but the same quarry that provided the initial granite for that.
Not really.
The other company is on the West Coast.
Yep.
And so the monies to have them come out and do a full estimate seemed like it was irresponsible to
I wasn't at all trying to throw a rock at your process. I was curious what the range, if there was a range.
Reach out to all of the local granite companies, and nobody has the equipment or the expertise to really deal in these larger monuments. Vermont Granite Works also does a lot of work at Gettysburg, which is why they were a really good choice to have come up, because nobody knows that period like they do.
So there's no, like, out-of-work monument people in South Carolina?
No, unfortunately not.
Yeah, it is important, though. I notice at the base, it is important that we keep that base as clean as we can.
Absolutely.
I notice some of the trees and things are growing back in there, and they've got to come out.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't, it'll only make it worse. So maybe we can talk to the DPW about getting some of that out of there.
There's also kind of this weird, what looks like a water spout coming out of the ground from when there used to be shrubbery around the bottom of the monument. So ideally, once the monument is removed, that creates an open space for the DPW or whoever would be responsible to kind of clean that area out and prepare it for replanting without these growing or plants growing out.
Yeah. Right. Just consider putting it somewhere else. Right. It's obvious to go put it exactly where it was, but maybe 10 feet to the left or 100 yards to the right makes better sense.
More centered on the common.
Whatever you think is right for future planning for the whole common. Maybe it's perfect where it is. I have no idea or comment. Just food for thought.
Thank you. So we'll be publicizing for a committee to be convened.
Thank you so much. And I'll make sure that you all get a copy of the in-depth quote that we received.
Thank you so much.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, we do.
She does a good job.
All right.
Either way.
Am I throwing this to town administrator or Mr. Falvey, the massage parlor?
You can throw it to me.
And you have the massage parlors. Or we shouldn't call them massage parlors. We should call them Asian body work.
We should call them fronts for prostitution and illegal sex trade activities.
Yep.
I mean, that's what
that
they are.
Better.
So Steve and I have kind of worked together on this with town council, and it came from our last meeting where I kind of brought up the civil forfeiture thing, and that spun into a whole lot of research and discussion. And in our discussion back and forth about, you know, what's the approach and how should we do it, we kind of came to the realization that this board, obviously, our job, if we're going to take a stand and be active and aggressive on anything in this town, this ought to be it. So that's kind of what we're proposing here. And so we set to work with town council to draft a letter that makes it clear that we care about the town, but first and foremost, we care about society and the negative effect this has on young women in our society and who are brought here potentially in a human trafficking instance, you know, against their will to perform in this trade. So, you know, that is really the overarching issue. The fact that it's in Wakefield is really secondary to that. So we've addressed all of it in a pretty forward letter to property owners in the town. It's in the packet, so the newspaper has a copy of it as well. But it will go out to all of the property owners who are identified either through the police department or through these publicly available websites that basically almost perform like Yelp, if you know what that is, and provide ratings on the degree and cost and you know how great the services were that they received at these establishments. So the fact that this stuff is going on is really a matter of public record. It's out there for the public to hold landlords, for now, responsible for having that knowledge and either doing something or not doing something about it. And so the letter puts them on notice that we're also not going to wait for them to do something about it. We're going to do something about it. And we'll start with a civil forfeiture process where which can only be undertaken if there's human trafficking going on. So not just, you know, but the way the law works is certain crimes have this remedy available to government agencies. So drug trafficking has that, but human trafficking does as well. So to the extent any human trafficking is occurring, which, you know, one typically goes hand in hand with the other in these trades, to the extent that's going on, we will proceed and take action against the property owners. You know, that's our plan, or that's what I'd like our plan with the blessing of the board, right? To start figuring out what our remedies are and how to do it. And if a property owner, this letter basically, and asks them, you know, please do something about it, but be on notice, we're doing something regardless. And hopefully this gets their attention. It would get mine if I owned property. You know, it's really, it's our suggestion, again, to this board, and this board hopefully will adopt this and approve it going out, but it's a suggestion that this board take a really strong stance and protect, you know, all citizens in our society and the citizens of Wakefield, and then, of course, property values and everything that flows from that. So we're not going to stand for this in our town, and we also don't want to just kick it down the road to some other town either. So we'll involve all levels of law enforcement in our fight. But I have daughters, I have families, we all do. I don't appreciate this on any level, anywhere, for any reason, and certainly not in our backyard. And I think it's this board's job to take a stand. So, Steve, you can please add.
I just wanted to say that it was a great collaborative effort between Valvey, Town Council Mullen, the police chief who was involved in it, the chair was involved in it. So I think it is a forward letter to the business owners, telling them that that's not what we're all about in Wakefield. That's what we shouldn't be about as a society, as Selectman Valvey said. I had the opportunity to talk to two property owners that I knew personally, to tell them that there was something coming out, that their name was going to be in a letter that was public record. And they were both very grateful that I was bringing it to their attention, because one was an out of state, mm-hmm. and actually a commercial broker had placed the business in there, yep. for them. And they were appalled, and wanted apologetic and didn't get it. In fact, they were actually on the rating website with me, appalled that their property was on there and that this was going on in their property. So I think, yep.
Yes.
And another business owner, property owner called me. He was out of as far away you can get in this country on vacation. I left him a message. He called me right back. He said, Steve, whatever you want. I didn't like that when they went in. So I think that they're looking for some help, too. So I think this is kind of two-pronged. We're giving them some help for those that were perhaps not as aware as they maybe should have been. And I think the others will that maybe are aware that they should be called on the carpet for this. You know, we work too hard as a board, as a community, from the Economic Development Committee with Pat Glynn to Paul DiNocco, Selectman DiNocco. We're trying to do to build up this community. This doesn't help us. So I think it's a great collaborative effort. You know, as I said to Brian, when you had BC, Harvard, and Georgetown, and Brown, good things happen, right?
So. Yep, absolutely. Any comments? All good?
I would just like to say, Madam Chairman, that for the people out there that think we're the ones that regulate this, these are state regulated. I have to watch my, I was going to say something, that we could really rectify the situation would be to maybe get our Board of Health to have some regulations and then to, you know, let them know that we're not going to have this place turn into some honky-tonk combat zone, a cheap dump that people come up 128 or up 93 or down 95 and pull in for 15 minutes and then hit the road. You know, This is not going to be one of those towns. We owe it to the people in this town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I call it the pronoun people syndrome, right?
Yeah.
So who lets them do that? Right, how do they let them do that? Well, guess what? Everybody at this table is they.
We're
the pronoun people.
That's
when
right.
People talk about them. So they are not going to allow it.
No.
They are going to take a very aggressive stance and find remedies beyond our local bylaws to make sure.
I don't think these letters are too heavy-handed either.
No.
They're not too heavy-handed at all. No. And many of them are going out of town.
Hopefully for the ones who, and we, you know, it ends with an invitation to come in and talk, and we'll
right.
help you, right?
Yeah.
So I think there are good folks out there who don't
right.
know,
and right.
I have a suspicion that there are folks who might be looking the other way, don't want to know, but really like that rent check, and you know, that's the kind of thing that here, this is very, very serious business, but that type of mentality also extends to things like upkeep of your building. Yeah, I just like the rent check. I know it's hurting the downtown.
Well,
we need this type of approach on everything, but certainly nothing has ever been more important than this.
Yeah, and I'll just say good job being a watchdog for the downtown, for the police, Brian and Steve. And great job collaborating.
Mm. Excellent. All right. Do we need a motion to send those lovely?
I don't think you do, but you might be speaking.
Sure. Is there a motion and a second to authorize the sending out of the letters to the property owners, warning them of potential criminal activity in their properties?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Next, we have we need a motion to approve the transfer in the amount of $385,187.50 from the town's capital projects, specifically athletic fields and Galvin accounts, to the general account.
So moved.
Second.
Move Paul. Second. Betsy. All in favor?
Aye.
Another motion to approve the transfer in the amount of $1,083,275 from the town's capital projects account to the general account.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Paul, second by Betsy. All in favor?
Aye.
The third treasurer motion is a motion in the amount of $677,825 from the town's capital projects account to the general account.
So moved.
Second.
Moved Paul, Betsy, seconded by Betsy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Excellent. We have a motion to approve the request of the Lucius Beebe Memorial Library to accept and expend a gift to the library in the amount of $25,798.09 with thanks.
So moved.
Moved, Paul.
Second.
Second. Pat, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The enclosed warrant article, is there a motion to accept the warrant article for the 2015 fall town meeting that has not yet been named when
so
we are
moved.
Having it?
Second.
Move Paul, second Betsy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We need a motion to...
I'm going to abstain on that. I'm just not prepared to. Sorry.
Okay. Note Brian's abstention. a motion to approve the July 23rd, 2015 and August 2015 movies by the lake.
So moved.
Moved, Betsy.
Second.
Second by Paul. All in favor?
Aye.
Yeah, this was, if I could speak on that. As you know, we had three movies scheduled. And the first movie, which was on July 2nd, part of the July Independence Day weekend in Wakefield, there were close to 400 people, 350 to 400 people enjoying it, families enjoying the movie on the common. Hopefully tomorrow night's a little bit cooler, or the next one will be a little bit cooler than it is tonight. But great. So the rec department and WCAT and the savings bank opted to get more. And at tomorrow night, or the 23rd, Thursday night, which is the Back to the Future, there is going to be a DeLorean there.
Really?
If you know the movie, there's going to be a DeLorean there, and I think people can take pictures with it.
Oh, awesome.
And what have you, and some other paraphernalia. And I think it's a great family event, so people get out and enjoy it.
Great. The next motion, I believe...
If you don't mind, Madam Chair, we have a request from the Conservation Commission to accept a parcel of land. I think it's kind of over the tracks at the bottom of Fitch Court. I think that when this board sells land, it's very due diligent and goes through a process where all the town departments weigh in. I think we should do the same thing when we accept land. Down at the end of that street, there have been some buildings in the past that maybe they had some activities going on there that we don't want to take ownership of. I'd like the other town department heads to weigh in on this and take a look. So I'd ask that we table that and bring it back to the next meeting.
Makes a lot of sense. Okay. We also, the last couple of pieces of business, we need to set an open hearing, a public hearing for a liquor transfer from Duck Walk to...
Yes, Duck Walk is changing hands, and rumor has it's going to be I'm going to say it's kind of like a 99 type of restaurant coming in, being whenever that is. I think you want it the 24th?
Yeah, I'll do that next.
Okay, that we would have a public hearing, a normal liquor license transfer public hearing at our next meeting.
Perfect.
So I do need a motion for that, Madam Chair.
So moved.
Second.
Motion to set the public hearing by Paul, seconded by Betsy.
I'll make it at 7:40.
What's the date for that?
7:40. Well, that's what I'm proposing right now.
Oh, sorry.
The date, as I believe was projected forward, was August 17th.
Mm-hmm.
But that, I will be away, my first vacation in over a year. So I'm hoping to move it to August 24th, if that works for a majority of us. Yes?
I'll be on vacation.
How about it?
You'll be out, Paul?
I'll be on vacation. I'm going on vacation after the festival.
We can see if we'll have a quorum.
I'll be here.
August 24th?
Phyllis, August 24th, will you be here?
As of now, we'll set it for August 24th. And if there's a problem, we can address that. And so that's when the public hearing will be held.
At 7:40, did you say?
7:40 on August 24th. Mm-hmm. Okay. Going around to see if anyone has any comments. Brian?
No, I think I said plenty tonight. Just back on on the ZBA thing, to be clear, because you guys all made some good points about being respectful to people. Mm-hmm. I think I said in my words, I don't condone it, but I do understand it. That's all. Mm-hmm. I understand that ZBA members are human beings, and sometimes your emotions get the best of you. I think they do a great job all of the time, and I think they heard from us tonight, but I guess still give them my full support, especially in the face of some of the things they have to sit straight faced on. It can get hard and long in a volunteer job like that. So,
Paul.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A few items. Steve, to you, Madam. Do we have any results yet from the Traffic Advisory Committee on Montrose and Water?
No, but those new signalization up there has been put in, the new signals, so they're cycling.
That's on Salem and Montrose. How about the site distance on water that I asked you?
No, but we have a meeting on August 10th.
Okay,
so
very good. Could you have Rick contact the state, or could Rick have the DPW clean the brush at exit 42? when you pull up, and I use that exit every day to get home, when you get to that set of lights, you cannot see right or left.
The grass?
Yes.
It really is like 5 feet high.
I just don't understand why they're not mowing it. On boats.
This has happened before with the state. We will let them know.
That whole area needs to be cut down because you can't see the cars on Salem Street. It's an accident waiting to happen. The EPC is requesting that you contact the billboard people once again, please, to promote the festival.
Yep.
If possible.
Do you have a...
We want them to use the same one as last year, but just change the dates. That was worked very well. My last two announcements is tickets are on sale for the dinner for the Italian Festival for August 21st. And the event is August 22nd, the Saturday. If you're able to volunteer for a couple of hours, please contact us. We can take as many able bodies. Other than that, I have it. Thank you.
Phyllis. First thing I want to say is I'm a little angry tonight. I resent the statement from Mr. Tarbell about where I get my information from the school. I want people to know, I read the paper very carefully. I've been reading about that project for a long time, and I've also heard some of those comments from the building committee. It's not something that I just think of out of the blue. And this is all very important to me. When you're a person like me and you've got to pay $800 more a year on your personal income tax property, you have the right to ask those questions. So I just want everyone to know exactly how I feel. And I follow everything very carefully. I don't make it up and I don't look for a problem. The second thing is, I know the DPW is working for Salem Street and Vernon Street. They've got to start tarring it or fixing it. It's like, there's so many bumps, there's so many roads, it's taken so long to do it. It's like going through an obstacle course to go through there. And even though you go slowly over the bumps, it's not good for tires, it's terrible. So I'm hoping that the DPW will get to take care of that, okay? And then the third thing is, I want to really give my sympathy to Dennis Fazio on the death of his father, because they're a wonderful family, and I know how close Dennis was, and I know how he was with his mother, so I feel very badly about that, and I know we all sympathize with him in that area. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, Phyllis, I apologize for chiming in. I probably should have just let you go back and forth with them. I had a part in it, and I just was trying to... for partaking. And I'll just appeal once again. I hope all the young kids in town are enjoying the summer with plenty of activities. I know that the new rec director is hard at work, and we have a new athletic director as well. I sure hope that at some point we can get swimming back in Lake Quinnipowhat safely for our kids in town so that they have a place to go swimming, cool off in this heat. So,
thank you, Madam Chairman. I echo Phyllis's sympathy from myself and my family to Dennis Fazio's family. Please don't forget the food pantry. I know people are going away this summer, and sometimes they forget that there are those that cannot go away and maybe don't have much to look forward to when they stay at home. So I hope you'd go down and give a little bit of something to the food. My last thing is, actually, these last 2 days have been, in my opinion, brutal, you know, with the humidity and the heat. There are those in this community that do not have the wherewithal, maybe, to be in an air-conditioned area. Let me put it that way. And I'm specifically not targeting the elderly. I don't mean it that way. It was brutal. It was enervating. It was debilitating. And I'm wondering if there's anything that we, because part of our shtick, I think, is the quality of life in this town, as evidenced by some of the conversations we've had tonight, that we could possibly have for anyone that would feel very distressed. This is not going to be the last hot and muggy day of this gig this summer. It could go into August, and it will, and probably into September, where people could go for some relief. I feel very badly that people maybe don't know that they might can go. We certainly took care of people when there was that big water main break, remember, a couple of years ago, and we hauled in all kinds of water for people and everything. I think that's part of our community and being a community and helping one another. So if you could work with maybe, or investigate, you know, with the Board of Health maybe, and I'm not dumping it on them, but, you know, somewhere along the line, that there could be a place where people could come for relief. They don't have to, you know, move in there. Just, you know, everyone deserves to be comfortable, you know. It's just because I just think it was brutal. You know?
Right. So certainly during the daytime, there's the library and the senior center, but you're right, at night it is still very brutally hot.
I mean, even when that sun goes down, you say, God, you know, it's awful. And I just feel very badly that people, you know, you can only hang around a mall, a shopping center, a library, or any other air-conditioned place just so long before they're going to say, hit the road, get out of here. You know, you're loitering. Not that I've done it, because I have. They were very, no, but I mean, you know, you just, there should be a place for people. So, anyway.
It's critical, certainly.
Thank you.
Okay. Because of the heat, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
So second.
Moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.